Hello, this is a Syria update, October 10th, 2020. My name is Janice Kortkamp. Yesterday, the areas of Lattakia, Tartous, and Homs in Syria, these are the provinces there, were engulfed in flames, and many of those fires continue today. There were some 90 separate fires that started. These fires have consumed hundreds of acres of critical olive trees, citrus groves, pomegranate trees, gardens, farms, livestock, wild animals. They've threatened people's homes. Many homes are destroyed. People have had to be evacuated. Businesses, of course. There's a university that's threatened. And this is a devastating situation for the people there. And I wanted to explain why it's so particularly devastating. You know, we've seen horrific fires in many areas of the world. They're all horrific to see the pictures. People in California have been evacuated from their homes and other places. But this coming at this particular time in Syria is particularly hard, and here's why. Syria, of course, for almost 10 years now has been fighting for its life in this really what is can be summarized as a terrorist proxy regime change attempt war. And this was instigated by the US, Britain, Israel, France, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, and Qatar primarily, but with many other countries involved. And Syria was targeted for regime change. I've talked about over the years the many reasons why this has happened, none of which are the reasons that you're given in media or by government officials. But in effect, it has been a terrorist proxy regime change attempt war. And so after battling these numerous terrorist groups, extremist groups, armed groups that were all sponsored and armed by foreign governments against the sovereignty of Syria, basically to dictate who the leader of Syria could be and Syria's policies in regards to its other issues in the region, they've been mostly successful at that. And although there are terrorist cells and militant groups still active in many areas of the country, for the most part they've been defeated. Still the province of Idlib is under their control. Still some of their northern area is under control of the invading Turkish forces, which are there illegally with their occupation of Syrian lands. And of course the U.S. is illegally occupying areas in Syria, primarily the northeastern, almost one-third of the country, where the most significant oil fields are. Now the U.S. is there not fighting ISIS, as the American public have been told, but in fact they're there literally stealing Syria's oil. They're using that to finance the training and arming and equipping of mercenary forces in the region that they're trying to use to actually separate and divide Syria up into smaller countries. And they're using these, you know, supposed Kurdish troops, but there is no such thing as a unified Kurdish community. There are many groups within the Kurdish population in Syria. Some of them are these separatists who are taking the U.S.'s money and have their own agenda there in order to carve out a piece of Syria for their own. The Kurds are not in any way you know, they have no particular claim on that land and any more than any of the other 20-plus ethnic or religious groups that live in Syria. This is just a force that the U.S. has put together in order to achieve their agenda in the country. In addition to that, the U.S. occupies a base in the south called El Tanf, and I can talk about that in future reports. But in any event, the U.S. occupation is completely illegal by international law and by our own American laws. The justifications used do not fit in this particular case. So, in addition to having spent the last almost 10 years really fighting these groups that had beheaded, had tortured, kidnapped, raped, and looted their way around Syria as they were taking control of many areas in the country, most of those have been defeated, as I've said. And that was a total effort on the part of the Syrian people, the Syrian army, and the Syrian leadership. In the course of those 10 years, as what happens in every war situation, you know, corruption has become much worse. They have smuggling, they have a black market, they have inflation, they have a devastation of their economy through, you know, destruction of infrastructure, a lot of the workforce leaving, you know, all of these aspects kind of work together to just make things very hard, the living very hard, and has resulted in inflation that has been devastating for most of the people there. So while before the war the middle class was the largest and the fastest growing segment of the population, now the middle class has been gutted, literally, and more people really are poor. Many of the previously poor are starving, and you know, the corrupt ones get richer, and the non-corrupt, you know, the other people, the normal people, get poorer and poorer. So, for example, prices are such now that to buy just a few pounds of chicken literally would cost your entire month's salary. Before the war, Syrians could live on 50 or 100 or 200 US dollars a month. Most of the salaries there are between, you know, 50 and 100 US dollars. At that time, in 2011, the Syrian lira, the Syrian dollar, was worth about 50 to 1, so 50 Syrian lira to 1 US dollar. And now the exchange rate is up in the mid-2000s, so it's about 2,400 to 1. Now salaries haven't changed. So something that you could afford easily before the war is now completely out of the realm of possibility with this current economy. And that's been a horrific situation. In addition to the high prices, there's been a lot of lack of basic services. Electricity in some areas just recently had gotten down to about an hour or two a day, and I've heard that's improved somewhat. But gas lines to fuel your car, for example, people can wait in line literally 20, 22, 24 hours just to get some gas for your vehicle. And this has been devastating as well. We've got the winter coming up. The heating fuel situation could be another horrific nightmare for the Syrian people. Now, with these fires, those areas of the Tartous, Lattakia, Homs countryside, these are some of the most greenest, most beautiful areas of Syria. Often it's rolling hills that are terraced with just hill after hill of olive trees and pomegranates and citrus, even apples. Everybody has their own garden where they raise, you know, vegetables for their family, and there are farms there. Many of these families, you know, this is their income, is to sell their produce, and now that produce has been destroyed. These olive trees, many of which are, you know, hundreds of years old, where every family had a little olive grove, and at harvest time the whole family goes and they pick the olives and they process them, and they process the oil and the olives themselves, and they can live on this if need, you know, if need be. By one friend was just describing, you know, some people said if all they have is a little olive oil, a little salt and some bread, they can exist. And now those olive trees are gone, and it will take years and years for them to possibly come back. Same with the citrus groves, where it can take 5, 10 more years for them to produce. So this is a terrible blow to the Syrian people. Based on comments and posts that I've seen from people there, I would say the consensus is that they do believe that these were deliberately started. Given the fact that these are green areas, even though it's been a hot year, and they were started at a very propitious time for making sure that they would spread quickly because of the strong winds that were happening yesterday. There's been no result that I've seen of the investigation. It's not my place to say, oh, this happened or this happened, of course. I'm waiting for more and more information, but certainly if they were started, it would be not only a horrific crime against humanity, but there would be a strategic reason for it, and that is to drive people off the land, to drive people into more desperation, to increase the suffering. And, you know, this has been a pattern of policies of Syria's enemies, is to make the people so miserable that they will rise up and perform a regime change for the Western and regional allies powers to be. So that is definitely a possibility. I'm not saying for a fact that's what happened. There's just not enough information yet. But I would say that there are many people in Syria that do believe these fires were deliberately started. And I'll update you with more as I find out. In the meantime, the soldiers in the army have been enlisted to help fight the fires. They have put many out. Also, residents, of course, have been working often with just shovels. There are some helicopters coming in. Iran has sent a plane. A firefighting plane in to help douse the fires. And Syrians have, I've seen a lot of networking going on of people opening their homes to those who have been evacuated from those areas. This is a terrible tragedy, and I will update you as I can with more information. Thank you for watching.